Okay, legal considerations of ethical hacking. Just going back to what we have started with, ethical hackers' actions have to be legal all the time. Okay, so for that, there has to be, first of all, these ethical boundaries that we keep us within. Okay, do no evil, do no harm. And there has to be some paperwork, and there has to be some work done as well, not just on paper. So first of all, what we have started off is that our actions have to be authorized by the owner of a system we hack. Yeah, so this normally takes a form of some rules of engagement document. Normally it's an engagement letter that the owner of the system issues to us, describing what can be done, within what dates, and to what systems, yeah, stating the scope of the assessment. And sometimes they refer to some other legal document, like an agreement or an invoice or something like that, and what they can have or they cannot have this list of different actions that can be done. But sometimes they just have the explicit list of actions that cannot be done. For example, exploiting denial of service conditions intentionally is strictly forbidden, and so on. So this document is very important because saves you a lot of legal trouble in case something goes wrong. Yeah, not that something goes wrong all the time, but yeah, things happen. And it's providing you with the strict scope. Scope can be stated somewhere else, again in an agreement or some other document of this sort. But the rules of engagement state that only this scope is legal to be hacked into. Okay, so this is very important. That's what leads us to scope validation. That's some open source intelligence, I guess, or some non-intrusive scanning that can result in you being sure that what is in this engagement letter stated as a scope of the assessment is actually belongs to this client. So you in this way find the relation between this authorization letter and the specific client. This is very important to do in the very beginning of the project because sometimes clients make mistakes, you know. So not that I know of any dramatic examples, but sometimes clients just provide the scope statements that include something they do not own. Okay, so yeah, this is very important to validate the scope before you start to do nasty things to it. What's incident response? So it can happen in two ways. So incident doesn't imply anything good. Okay, so first of all, it can be like the result of your actions. So you caused an operational incident while pen testing the scope. You're a good guy, remember that. Even if you play a bad guy, you have to remain good. So every time you see that something just stops and doesn't work after you push the button, okay, you have to report that. You have to put anything you do on pause, on hold, and then report to the client, to the responsible personnel that is normally listed in the rules of engagement as well, with emergency contacts and all this kind of stuff. You have to report and you have to wait further instructions, okay? So sometimes it takes some time to recover the operations. And the second thing, you can discover a security incident already in action. This is the most trickiest part, okay? So you have found a vulnerability, you just went in somehow, okay? And you understand from what you observe further that you are not the first guy here, okay? So someone else is already in the room. again, you just put everything on hold and report the situation to the client and wait for further instructions, because they can, but most probably they won't consult you about what to do in this situation, because they have their legal staff, they will contact law enforcement and whatever. Your main role here is not to tamper with evidence, not to change anything, to retreat immediately and collect all the evidence, because you have to base your conclusions upon something. But still, you don't have to change anything, because that can lead to law enforcement inability to prosecute the wrongdoers. Reporting, we already discussed in the very much detail. However, we will do it again soon, but here in legal considerations, you have to remember that the report doesn't have to be linked to you. Not in the manner that the authorship should be destroyed. Yeah, the any sign of you writing the report should be destroyed. No, nothing should have to be left to interpretation. So a reader of the report should have all required information in it already. So they don't have to go to you to contact you in order to verify some additional details. It should be written in a way that you can commit this explicit transaction of intellectual property. Yeah, so it's a complete document that you just take into your hands and pass over to your client, and that's over. Okay, so that belongs to them right now. And there is no need to consult you to yeah, you will have different sessions in order to explain all the different details, and you will have multiple versions of a draft. But in the end, you will have to be able to just make this over, and the client can benefit from your work just by reading the report. And just to mention here, I'm not sure whether certified ethical hackers should be knowledgeable about this stuff, but still, it can be very useful to you to have this professional or contractual liability insurance. It's provided in different locations. You can consult your insurance broker or anyone who is knowledgeable in all this stuff. It's not. Again, not everything goes wrong all the time. Yeah, but these cases, if you are an ethical hacker and you are skillful enough to avoid these situations, these things are rare. These cases are very rare, but still, it can save you a lot of legal trouble. First of all, yeah, if there is some contractual liability and you will have to pay some penalties, some fines in case you make a mistake. Or it can make your negotiations with your client's lawyers much more pleasant and much faster, you know, because sometimes they insist on unlimited liability. Sometimes they are satisfied with the liability in terms of like you compensating all the just paying back all the money that they have paid you in order for you to perform a penetration test. Yeah, so it can be very different. Sometimes they're very not very flexible, I would say, in a politically correct way, okay? And they insist on unlimited liability, and in this case, your insurance company can help you save a lot of time negotiating the terms of the contract. Okay, so that's pretty much it for the frame of reference that we will use throughout this video series. I can give you some guidance, not that this is critical to know further, but you can consult these URLs in order to know more what certified ethical hackers are, and what's the requirements to be certified, and what's the CIA tried in terms of other program that is more theoretical and broad, and takes this, I guess, much more seriously, then ethical hackers have to know and have to dig into it. Yeah, and there is a good list of penetration testing methodologies that are up to date. You know, there is also a lot of historical stuff, but what's up to date, what's modern and contemporary, can be found here. And of course, there are two very successful bug bounty brokers that have these lists of bug bounty programs active right now. You can consult what a bug bounty program brief looks like, and that can give you an idea about what the scope statement of a penetration test could look like, because bug bounty basically is just crowdsourcing penetration testing through the user base of these sites, the security researchers that rate very high in these bug bounty program aggregators. Okay, so that's pretty much it for the beginning. I guess I have preserved the integrity of your mind until this point, so we will continue with more practical and much more interesting stuff. See you in a while.